Thank you for turning up for the talk, and thank you to the NALSA Tech Law Forum for inviting me. I've come back to NALSA, I think, after 14 years. The last time I was here was in 2003 when I was writing the entrance exam. I didn't make it in the first cut. I was in the waiting list. So I spent the rest of my life explaining to people in Hyderabad that I studied at the NALSA in Bangalore. So my talk is going to be on the DU photocopy case. Now, rather than just get into the black letter of the law, I thought it would be interesting to go back into the history of how education and copyright law has been balanced in India. And I also covered it in my book, so it was easier for me to do that. So I'll just run you through a series of policy events starting back from 1914, actually. I should change the date over there. Dude, my face won't come. Turn off the lights. Oh, okay, fine. Just switch it off.
And the people in the last row read the text.
So, as you know, The debate on copyright law of late has always been, at least the last 10 years with the internet and you know, the access to information exploding all over the place, the debate has always been on how should the monopoly right be balanced with the access to knowledge component. Now, this is actually not a very new debate. This debate has been taking place in India for the last 100 years. So there's a lovely article by Professor Bentley in the Chicago Kent Law Review where he discusses one particular aspect of this debate in 1914 when the British were extending the Imperial Copyright Act to India. So the British did leave some space open for each colony to tailor the law to their own requirements. And the main issue of debate at that time was the right to translations. So initially, under the old, the 1847 Copyright Act, which the East India Company had brought in, and there's another British Colonial Act in 1842, none of those acts specifically recognized a copyright in translations. And Macmillan was fighting a few cases in the 19th century, and there was a judgment which said that a translation is a completely new work, so you don't have to take the permission of the copyright owner to produce a translation. And as you can expect, at that time in India, where English-speaking people were probably less in number, vernacular languages were the primary medium of education, and hence there was a huge market in translations. So the dispute at that time was, ironically, it was between the British administrators of India who saw the requirement to translate English language, textbooks and literature into vernacular Indian languages, because it was a part of their mission to, the white man's burden to educate the Indian masses and show them the light. And on the other hand, there was a very strong British publishing lobby which wanted to restrict this right. They wanted to the copyright law to specifically recognize that translations were covered in the bundle of rights for copyrights. So that led to a debate, and what the Britishers did is they introduced a limited translation right. That is, if you did not introduce a translation of your work within the first 10 years of your copyright, then the copyright in the work extinguished and anybody else could publish it. I'll explain why this is relevant a little bit more, a little bit down the lecture. Now, the first debate that we had on copyright law in India was in 1952. These were good old days when the government actually used to come to Parliament and ask for its blessings before it went ahead and signed any treaties or conventions. So they would have a debate, there would be a resolution which the government moved. And once that was voted on, they would go back to usually Geneva, if it was IP, and sign a treaty. These days, it doesn't happen at all. We sign the WTO agreement and TRIPS without a single proper debate in Parliament. So the first debate that was happening was in 1952. And the topic of the debate was whether India should ratify the latest revisions to the Berne Convention. I'm presuming all of you know what the Berne Convention is, but I'll just introduce it briefly. It's the main copyright convention which was entered into in 1886. It was set up mainly by very rich, developed European countries who also made their colonies parties to the convention, regardless of the fact that it wasn't really in their best interests. So this was a setting for the debate. And what was interesting was, post-independence, a few colonies had actually walked out of the Berne Convention. So you had Indonesia, which just walked out. They said that we're not going to be a part of this convention anymore. And if given the climate of the time, you would have expected that even the Rajya Sabha would have said that we should probably walk out. But what happened in the debate was exactly opposite, where all these MPs ganged up on the poor education minister, the junior education minister at the time, saying that, why are you dragging your feet on this convention? Why have you not already signed it? And in fact, one of them, Rama Rao, he went far enough to ask the government to deliver a warning to the US to bring its copyright laws in line with the rest of the world, which is ironic if you look at the newspapers these days. It's the US government which is beating us with that stick. The reason for this was, back in the day, the US was seen as a bit of a outlier to copyright law. They weren't a part of the Berne Convention. They were only a part to the UCC much later. In fact, for the first 100 years of America's independence, they did not recognize foreign copyrights. And after the 100 years that they started recognizing foreign copyrights, they had a domestic requirement clause, which meant that you had to publish the book within the US to for the copyright to be recognized. And that's it. At the time, it was a sensible policy move, because if you're trying to build your domestic industries and you had to stand up against developed British monopolies, it was a policy which did make sense at the time. Now, one of the reasons probably the Rajya Sabha was so very hostile to this move of the reason that they were really in favor of probably signing the Berne Convention was they had a disproportionate number of people who were authors and writers, because as you know, the Rajya Sabha doesn't have direct elections, so a lot of people who were elected were usually writers, authors. So Rama Rao was actually the first editor of the National Herald, which is, thanks to Subramanian Swamy, is back in action and printing their papers. So the first substantive law reform that the government took in the area of copyright law was in 1955. This was 3 years after the Berne Convention. And the government introduced a new copyright bill, which has been praised by Professor Upendra Bakshi. He's written a wonderful piece in, I think, the Journal of the Indian Law Institute. And he praised it as one of the few laws which, you know, had an Indian flavor to them and which took care of the Indian needs and wasn't a mere cut-copy-paste of British legislation, which still happens in India. Now, the interesting part of the Copyright Bill 1955 was that, A, it sought to reduce the term of copyright law from life plus 50 years to life plus 25 years. And second, it sought to introduce a copyright registration requirement, which is not allowed under the Berne Convention. And the third major clause that they tried to introduce was compulsory licensing provisions, which meant that after a certain time period, anyone could file an application with the Copyright Office and seek to print that work with or without the permission of the copyright owner. Now, all three of these clauses are completely alien to Berne, but they were integral to the UCC, which is the Universal Copyright Convention, which was being negotiated at the time by the US. And the US was basically trying to create this a second international copyright union, because they didn't want to be a part of Berne. And if you actually go through the notes and clauses of the Copyright Bill 1955, they very clearly mention that this clause is modeled on the UCC. So it was, what comes across then from the Copyright Bill is they wanted to exit the Berne Convention, which is very strange if you think about it, because just 3 years ago you had a group of MPs blast the government for delaying signing the ratified version of the Berne Convention. So the probable strategy that time of the government was to get this bill passed, get out of the Berne Convention and join the UCC. And I presume life would have been very different for a lot of us if that had happened. So these were some of the authors who really protested. Any idea who they are? Any Biharis? Wow. Okay, so that man is Rambari Singh Dinakar. He's one of the most famous Hindi poets. He's from Bihar. And I think he was a nominated member at the time to Parliament. They have some reservations for authors and poets, people in the arts. I think Rekha and Javed Akhtar hold that position right now. The second person is Meenu Masani. Meenu Masani was one of the founding members of the Swatantrata Party. It was probably the only party in Indian history which supported the free market. And they had absolutely no qualms about saying that the government should not be in the business of doing business. And the Swatantrata Party played a very important role. At one point of time, they were the only major opposition party in India when Indira Gandhi was the Prime Minister. They opposed changes to the Copyright Bill. They opposed changes to the Patents Act 1970. And they're the only people who provide some flavor to the history of Indian IP law. So both these people came down heavily on the government for its version of the Copyright Bill. Now, Dinakar's explanation, which was in Hindi and I had to get it translated, it was, he gives a very unique argument for IP law in India. Usually, when people debate, say, copyright law in India, the standard argument is, oh dear, there's this, you know, I know this author, he's starving, we should get him more money, otherwise he's going to die, etc., etc. Dinakar was one person who tied in the copyright debate to the idea of democracy and liberty itself. He said that if you expect authors to be independent, have their own opinion, you cannot expect them to be dependent on the state for patronage. And copyright law is one way in which authors can earn their own royalties and survive in the market without depending on the government. I mean, those are really true words, especially in India today. Meenu Masani was a barrister by trading, so he went back to the black letter of the law and he took up the Berne Convention and said that you people are going to violate the Berne Convention, we are going to be expelled from the international community. And then he ranted against the creation of the Copyright Office and said, I'm not going to go to some minion of the government to register my copyright. And both of them, to their credit, had a lot of publications. Even Meenu Masani, we probably don't study his books anymore, but he's written a lot about the law. I think maybe he was a member of the Constituent Assembly, I'm not sure about that. So that's the side of the authors in the Rajya Sabha. And at the time, they also had a lot of support coming in from PEN, which is the Poets, Essays, Poets, Novelists, and Authors Association. CSAC is a French version of that, and then there's the British Copyright Council. Now, authors are pretty well networked internationally. A lot of them do collaborate on a lot of these issues. So you see PEN issuing statements even today in India on the issue of, you know, journalistic freedom and artistic freedom. So all of these guys got into the fray. They went before a joint parliamentary committee which was examining the bill at the time. Unfortunately, the depositions before the JPC have been misplaced by the Lok Sabha. They've just lost it. So the only thing that they have is the report. But the problem with parliamentary reports is that they aren't very detailed, because they just presume that you're going to look at the depositions to get the verbatim arguments that took place before the committee. So the JPC basically agreed with the authors. They said that, you know, we shouldn't risk leaving the Berne Convention. They said drop these controversial clauses. and they also recommended the introduction of a couple of clauses. One of them was Section 52(1)(i), which is at dispute in the DU photocopy case. And the second one was a clause where they called for limited translation rights. This was again something which was very similar to what the British had introduced in 1914, which they said that you either introduce a translation within 10 years or you lose your copyright in the translation. For some reason, this was deleted from the Copyright Bill 1955, but the JPC wanted it back. Now, when the bill went back to Parliament, you had very few authors, surprisingly, actually opposed the move of the JPC to reject the amendments which to reject the proposals which the government had put forth. And the arguments that they made at the time were very commonsensical. One argument was, you can't let people who are going to be affected by the process itself be debating in Parliament like this. I mean, let me put it another way. If, say, Vijay Mallya was an MP in the Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha debating aviation policy, most of us would cry out that it's a conflict of interest, the ethics issues involved. But for some reason, the authors always get away with it. We've seen it happen as recently as 2012, where Javed Akhtar basically steamrolled the Copyright Amendment Bill through Parliament, and nobody really raised the ethics issue at all. And that's because there's a certain romanticism which is associated with lawyers, and it's the foundation on which the edifice of copyright law is built, you know. We all think that there's this romantic author who is, you know, sitting in some hill station writing a book, while it's actually a publisher who's wearing a, you know, a top dollar suit who's actually making the profits behind the scenes. So the two arguments that one of the MPs raised from AP, coincidentally, Keshav Chand, the one argument was that he raised the issue of zamindars. He said that we are, if you remember, the 50s was a time when they were doing away with zamindari. They were abolishing land titles, they were placing ceilings on land holdings. So he said that if we are doing the redistribution process for land, why should it be any different for copyright law? Why don't we tone it down from what the British gave us? And the second issue that he raised was obviously that India was headed for a socialistic economy at the time. And one of the major aims of the government at the time was to improve literacy, improve education standards, which is very difficult to do if you have to pay a high royalty fee to copyright owners around the world. So both very sensible arguments, but surprisingly very few people made them. Keshav Chand and probably another person, a couple of other MPs were the only people to make this argument. The authors had everybody else in their camp. So the final vote, at the time, Maulana Azad was the first, he was the first education minister of independent India. And the debates, in the debates, Dinakar, he tells the Rajya Sabha, you know, Maulana Azad was so understanding, we went to him once and we expressed our outrage and he understood immediately. He asked us to, you know, form a small committee, prepare a report, and he promised to act on it immediately. And which seems is finally what, that's what happened. Because when the final vote happened, the ministry said that, okay, we're dropping all the controversial clauses. So the term of copyright went back to life plus 50 years. They did away with the registration requirements. The compulsory licenses somehow still survived. The authors, for some reason, seem to have missed it. But as Srimali was at the time, he was the junior minister, so he wasn't the main minister. I think he was the minister for state. So he cited strong public opinion, and he also very presently warned the authors that, you know, your genius, I think he put it very eloquently, so I'll just repeat it. The author does not exist in a vacuum. The individuality of the genius does not express itself in isolation. In protecting the interests of the authors, we should not forget the interests of society in general. Now, that's a classic utilitarian argument, which is very strange coming from a man who went ahead to torpedo all the amendments which have done exactly that. But the 1955 debates So these debates happened in 1957 when the act was passed. They show the debate, the complexity of the copyright law debate in India and the rest of the world. You know, it's your classic natural rights versus utilitarian rights phenomena. Do you support the right of the individual or do you go and balance the rights of the society? So it's a fascinating debate which has surprisingly not been explored too much in Indian copyright law, at least the recent scholarship. Around the 60s, we had a new education minister. This is Chief Justice M.C. Chawla. He was the Chief Justice of the Bombay High Court for, I think, 10 years. And then he served as a diplomat to both the UK and the US, experience which helped him later in his efforts because, as he mentioned in his biography, Roses in December, you should read it if you haven't read it, where he mentions that one of his challenges as the Minister of Education was copyright law, because the cost was actually becoming an obstacle to providing greater access to educational material for India's teeming masses at the time. And he specifically mentions the international conventions because of the 1955 debates, where we saw the government trying to change the law, and the authors pushed back saying that you're going to be violating international law. So they were drawing the legitimacy from the argument that India had certain treaty obligations. So what Justice Chawla set out to do basically, along with a very enterprising registrar of copyrights called T.S. Krishnamurthy, they just decided to change international copyright law at the time. So they joined forces with the African countries, who had a conference in Brazzaville in the 60s, where even they had decided that they wanted to change how copyright law works because it just wasn't serving their own national interests. So there were a series of debates starting from meetings and conferences from 1962, ending in 1967, where the Indian Copyright Office had held a debate, a conference in Delhi, just before a major conference in Stockholm in 1967 to revise the Berne Convention. And if you look at the way policy was made in India at that days, it was amazing because T.S. Krishnamurthy held this conference, he called people from across the world, published the conference proceedings in a journal, gave up the government copyright in the journal and said whoever wants to use it can use it, and then made that publication available all across the place. And I found it in a library in Stanford. It's probably not there in most of the Indian libraries. So, I mean, that was the sophistication with which these guys proceeded at that time. So the major demands at the Stockholm conference were again a repetition in large part of the demands that the Indian Parliament had rejected in 1955. So the format at the time was they wanted to introduce a protocol to the Berne Convention, and the protocol would be applicable only to developing countries for a period of 10 years. And what it would allow people to, these countries to do was to reduce the life, the term of copyright again to life plus 25, to extinguish translation rights if translation rights weren't published in 10 years. Then they wanted to allow compulsory licensing, special exceptions for education and scholastic activities, and this was, they want a really broad exception, that is, you don't even pay any kind of royalty. Compulsory licenses, you pay some kind of compensation, a just or equitable compensation, there are a lot of fancy words for that term. But they wanted a pretty broad exception for educational and scholastic activities. And the final restriction was they wanted to impose national currency restrictions, which means if a foreign publisher, copyright owner, earns any royalties in India, he could be paid back only in Indian rupees and not foreign currency. And in the 50s, Indian rupees weren't worth much. So this led to what was called at that point of time the crisis in international copyright. Now the reason for this is the Berne Convention was by copyright standards a very, very conservative convention because the Europeans offer extremely high protection to authors. In fact, they don't even call it copyright, they call it author's rights. So it's seen as something the European conception, the civil law conception of copyright law is that it's an extension of the author's personality. So that's where you get the issue of moral rights, that is, you cannot distort a copyrighted work or mutilate it out of context. So those are all very civil law concepts which were adopted by the British and filtered into Indian law. So for those guys, the agenda that was put forth at the Stockholm Convention was a shock. It was primarily a shock for the British, for UK and Mexico, because they had the most to lose commercially. The UK was one of the world's largest publishers and is still the largest publishers for English language textbooks and journals. And Mexico was the leader in Spanish language textbooks. So these guys had the commercial interests which were going to be hurt. And as Financial Times described the reaction of the British publishers at the time, they had the startled look of a milkmaid who had just been turned up by her favorite cow. You can trust only the British to come up with a line like that. And to signal its intentions, the seriousness of its intentions at the time, the Indian government actually sent a minister to head the delegation. That's pretty unheard of in these international conferences. So as you know, one of your professors, Vivekananda, he goes along with the government usually to negotiate these treaties. So the fact that the government of India sent a minister sent out a very powerful signal at the time that they meant business, that this had to be done. And one of the dangers at the time, which the Europeans were very aware of, was that if India decided to walk out of the convention, it would probably be joined by all the developing countries, and that would be the end of the Berne Convention. So they knew that there was a fine line to walk. Some of the other European countries like Sweden, whose financial interests weren't really at stake, they were a lot more understanding of the concerns of developing countries. So the difficulty for the British basically was how to balance these rights by keeping the Indians happy and protecting their own domestic publishers. So the British did what they always do. They negotiated with India in camera, introduced a lot of amendments which turned it so complicated that, again, as one of the British newspapers described it at the time, the agreement which emerged is so complicated that it could have only been drafted by the British civil service bent on destruction. So that was quite true, because the problem with copyright law, with compulsory licenses, is that the moment you introduce a requirement to contact the copyright owner, negotiate with him, the story ends over there. It's very difficult to proceed beyond that. So at the end of the day, the British agreed to a lot of the requirements. They just abstained from voting, because if they voted against this, that would be the end of the convention. They, however, made sure that even educational uses would be subject to some just compensation. And one of the big amendments that was made to Berne as a result of this was the three-step test in Article 9, which is the first major exception introduced in the Berne Convention, which basically allows you to use copyrights without the permission of the author, as long as some conditions are followed, that the author shouldn't, the normal exploitation of the work shouldn't be affected, the author should be compensated to some effect, etc., etc. Surprisingly at the time, the Indian, or actually not surprisingly at the time, both the Indian government and the British government faced a backlash. The British Copyright Council and a lot of British authors were extremely angry with the British government. They said, why didn't you just vote against the protocol? You would have killed it at the time, because most of the international agreements work on consensus. If one person votes against it, it's over. The British, obviously, they had their reasons. They didn't want the Indians to walk out of the convention. And there were several Indian authors who blasted the Indian government in an open letter, which was published, I think, in The Statesman, which was leading a campaign at the time against the Stockholm Protocol. The Statesman, which is published out of Calcutta, and which I think is, at the time, was headed by a British editor. Someone's told me, I have to confirm that. Now, these three men, if you didn't know Dinkar, I'm guessing you won't know at least the first two. The first is Nazim Eskil. He's a Jewish, Indian Jewish poet based out of Bombay. The second is A.G. Noorani. And of course, that is Kushwant Singh. I'm sure all of you know him. So they wrote an open letter to the government, basically calling the Stockholm Protocol piracy, although it is under the disguise of the law. And they also blasted the government, threatening them that, you know, we get so much British aid, you're threatening, you're jeopardizing the kind of aid that we may receive. And at the last, there is the fundamental moral issue of how can you use somebody's work without paying them. It's the strongest argument in an author's army, and they use it very, very effectively. So this was the backlash that the Indian government faced domestically. The only person to respond to this was again the Registrar of Copyrights, T.S. Krishnamurti. So he was very active, and he would write op-eds in newspapers. So he wrote a newspaper in, he wrote an op-ed in the Statesman again, basically trying to explain to these authors that we have greater, larger interests, which is the interest of educating our fellow countrymen, and these interests are in national interests. And he also subtly hinted to them that it appears that the major problem here is financial, because it's going to hurt your pockets. So that was the debate which happened in 67. Now surprisingly, or again not surprisingly, India actually never deposited the instrument of accession for the Stockholm Protocol. Only four countries did it. Pakistan was one of them. We didn't do it despite taking the lead. And in 1971, between 67 and 71, the Britishers had organized, Britishers and publishers on a whole, had organized a series of conferences across the world, and they finally came out with a consensus called the Washington Recommendations. And that was the agenda in 1971 for the what was then called finally the Berne Revision Conference 1971. They rolled back all of the gains that India had made in 67. They put in place a system of compulsory licenses which was extremely complicated. It was like, it's there in Indian law, you can see it right now in section 32 A and B. It's basically, I don't think it was very workable at the time. And the most interesting aspect of this, the revision conference in 1971 was that the Indian delegation consisted of three officials, Secretary of Home, Secretary of Education, and Secretary of Law. There was nobody from the Copyright Office who was there at those talks. So probably something happened in New Delhi and the message had gone out to the government that they need to tone back. So I'm guessing they made a change in the team that was sent to negotiate the Berne Convention. Now, these amendments took another 13 years to be implemented in India. In 1984, the government finally moved law to amend the Copyright Act and introduce these two provisions which were supposed to take care of meeting India's educational needs at the time. Now we'll come to the OUP versus Rameshwari and the Delhi University Press. I'm guessing, so that's a shop which was being sued by three big international publishers. I'm guessing all of you are familiar with the facts, but I'll just run through them quickly. The photocopy shop was actually affiliated to the Delhi School of Economics, which is one of the colleges under DU. And they were preparing course packs according to a syllabus prepared by the faculty at the DSE. So the students would pay around 50 paisa a page to the photocopy shop owner, and they would buy a course pack. So the course pack would, as you know, they consist of chapters from different books compiled into one publication. So the question now was the issue of So the problem now was the issue of repay of copyright in the material. Now this is a practice which has been going on in India for several years. As you know, like, I mean, when we were in college, which is I think about 10 years ago, it's a long time, NLS used to give out course packs for free to everybody. They used to charge us for it, but I don't think any money ever went back to the copyright owners. So what OUP and the Rameshwari photo, sorry, what OUP, CUP and Francis Taylor decided to do was to sue both the university and the photocopy shop and ask them for a share in the royalties. Now, what initially happened when the lawsuit was filed, there was a lot of misunderstanding amongst the students on what exactly the intention was, because the rumor that spread in Delhi University was that the publishers wanted the students to buy an individual copy of each book from which the chapter was there in the course pack, which meant someone did the calculations, it came up to 80,000 rupees. So there was a great outcry, and the publishers, like most IP owners in India, are completely ineffective in communicating what they wanted to do. So they got out, they got the story out at a very late time that their intention actually was to charge 50 paisa a page for photocopying the material. So their deal was that if 50 paisa goes to the guy who's making the copy, we deserve 50 paisa. So the cost of a course pack, which at that point of time was 250 rupees, would double to say around 500 rupees. So that was the intention. And this model was based on a model which was founded in the US in around the 90s. And there's a long story going back to that was very interesting, which goes back to the development of the Xerox 914, which was one of the first photocopying machines which made photocopying so simple that a chimp could do it. In fact, there's some advertisements which I wanted to show you. So wait just a minute. Okay, so this is one of the ads which they showed to me. Can I play it? Was a big thing, you know? So the FCC in the US refused to believe that this was possible because they have some regulatory control over networks or network broadcasts in the US. They said that there's no way a child can do this unsupervised. So Xerox at the time then decided to make an advertisement with a chimp.
Okay.
Okay, I think you get the idea. So anyway, after the after this particular advertisements, secretary started complaining that there were people were leaving bananas on their desks in the U.S. So they had to pull the advertisement from American networks. But anyway, one of the reasons that I showed that ad was at the time when the 914 was actually introduced in the U.S., photocopying was a very complicated business. There were chemicals involved, there were gloves involved. It could not be done so easily. So the photocopying machine with Xerox involved, the 914 was, in many respects, it was, you know, the Gutenberg's printing press of the 20th century. And if one thing that we've learned from the history of copyright law is that every time a new technology is introduced, copyright law changes. So one of the big fears that time for American publishers was what was going to happen to their royalties. And the first case that was filed in the 60s was by William and Wilkins, and they sued the NIH, which is the National Institute of Health. It's a government-run scientific establishment in the US. And Williams and Wilkins basically asked them for a share of the royalty that of the proceeds when every time they photocopied an article for one of their patrons. And NIH at that time just refused. They had the government lawyers simply said, we're not doing that. We give them, we usually copy only one article from a journal. We have certain restrictions, and that's covered under fair use. So at the time, the US didn't have a statutory fair use defense. It was a defense which was carved out by American courts in the course of their litigation. So the publishers finally ended up suing them. In the US, you can't get injunctions against the government. Over there, the Sarkar is the true Maibhav. So if even in the case of a copyright or patent infringement, there's no question of any injunction. You can only sue for damages. So it went to the Commissioner of Claims, who initially ruled in favor of the publishers and said, this is copyright infringement, it's not fair use. Then that went up to the appeals court, where the publishers lost, because the very simple point that the copyright owners made, the point that the copyright owners could not prove at the time, was you are not facing any substantial loss, because that was one of the criteria of the fair use defense in the US. So after they lost before the Court of Appeals, they went all the way to the US Supreme Court. And a tragic anticlimax, one of the nine judges recused himself. The remaining eight judges were split 4-4, which means that the Court of Appeals verdict stands. So anyway, the publishers managed to get around that by lobbying Congress. And in 1976, when the new Copyright Act was introduced, it specifically prohibited libraries from photocopying. So now that they got that out of the equation, the publishers then set up what's called the Copyright Clearance Center. So it's something like a collective rights organization. All the publishers were a part of the CCC. The idea was to make sure that each university took a license from the CCC. Every time they made a photocopy of any material and used it for their students, they would have to pay the CCC a certain royalty. Obviously, this obviously didn't happen very easily. They ended up suing Kinko's, which was a major photocopying company in New York. It's, I think, now FedEx. They won that case, the publishers. They went ahead and sued another guy in Michigan. So it was a long series of litigation, but finally they won. And American universities started paying the publishers through the CCC every time they used the material. Now, like all collective rights organizations in the world, especially when it comes to copyright law, there is a bit of abuse of their dominant position because they have a monopoly. There is no other alternative. You can't go to anybody else. So there was a bit of an abuse, and it happens all across the board. Now, the publisher's intention with the DU photocopy case was to replicate this model in India. So they wanted to make sure that certain royalties were paid. And the only way to go about this was to actually sit down and sue somebody, because they had tried negotiating with the government. They asked the Ministry of HRD to send circulars to all the universities, and no one followed up. So they decided to finally sue them. As you know, there were a lot of protests,
I mean, they picked the wrong university to sue because Delhi University is very politically active. And to the credit of the students, they set up an organization which was called, I think, ASIAC. It was a Association for Equitable and Just Access to Copyright Law, something like that. Oh, sorry, Association of Students for Equitable Access to Knowledge. So they brought in a lot of academics. There was Professor Shamnad Bashir, Lawrence Liang. Everybody got into the fray. They filed an intervention in the lawsuit, and they told the court that they wanted to argue on behalf of the students because they weren't quite sure what instructions were going out from Delhi University at the time. So the simple section which was a dispute was this, which is section 51I, which says a reproduction of any work by a teacher or a pupil in the course of instruction or as a part of the questions to be answered, etc., 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 will be an exception to copyright law. Now, one of the points that should be remembered with regard to section 52, which often gets confused in India, is that section 52 is a fair dealing exception, a fair dealing clause, which deals with both limitations and exceptions. So this is modeled on the British-style laws which we had from 1914, when the Britishers enacted extended the Imperial Copyright Act to India. So the way these provisions are structured is that there will be one general fair dealing clause which applies to certain private personal uses. The rest of them are usually exceptions. They are straight out exceptions. The problem that happens in India is because of so many American law review articles being available freely online, which discuss fair use, people get very confused. Fair use is a very different concept. The US has never had a clause in their law which has enumerated specific exceptions to the to copyright. They've had a fair use clause which lays down four criteria, that is the use commercial, how much of the use is being, how much of the work is being used, is it transformative in nature. So there are four factors like that which need to be assessed. Now in India and UK and civil law countries go the limitations and exceptions way. Singapore has a hybrid model. They have both the American fair use exception and they have the British style limitations and exceptions. Now, so if you go by this interpretation of section 52I, it's very clear that the provision is, to an extent, if you read it literally, it provides an exception to copyright without any restrictions, and that's how the Delhi High Court interpreted it. They said that there are no quantitative restrictions. As long as a student, as long as a teacher prescribes a certain material for class, anybody can get it, any student can get it photocopied, provided it's for the purpose of the class. Which basically means that they finished, they extinguished copyright in a lot of educational material. Now, one of the problems with the way this debate proceeded in the courtroom, I don't understand why the publishers did certain things that they did. So I just want to provide the other side of the story. One of the problems with the publisher's argument was they characterized the amount of photocopying as a percentage of the total book. So the range that they gave was 5% to 33%. That was actually the wrong way to put it across, because all of the works that were in the course pack were actually individual chapters in compiled works. So there would be, say, there would be one editor who would compile, say, articles from 10 different people, and articles were being plucked out and put into the course pack, which actually meant that an entire copyrighted work was being reproduced. Now that is an important point to be kept in mind, because a lot of this is also a mind game with the judge, you know. The Indian scenario, 10% chalta hai. Whole work, 100%, people will sit up and take notice what's happening. And the second argument which wasn't made was regarding section 52.1i, regarding section 32A and B. Now, as I've just explained the entire history of the Copyright Act, section 32A ended up in the Copyright Act to take care of India's educational needs. You may not agree with how the provision is structured because it's quite a nightmare to read it. But the very fact that there's a provision like that in the law means that you need to balance all other provisions in the law without destroying the meaning of that provision, because there is a general principle of statutory law that no provision can be interpreted in a way to render any other provision redundant. Now, this argument was just not taken up in court. I don't know why. So the other argument, this has nothing to do with copyright law. This is actually the question that's put up, which was running in everyone's minds at that time, was affordability, where both the students and the teachers came up and said that, you know, we can't afford to pay this. You guys are asking for too much money. But the problem with the Indian market is if you want to price copyrighted material, it is crazy. Because if you look at the way education is structured in India, in other countries, you usually have, you know, school primary education free and university education expensive. In India, it's the inverse. So you have Delhi Public School, which in 2012 was charging 45,000 rupees as tuition fee. There was a lot more additional charges. By 2017, they were charging 90,000. If you look at Delhi School of Economics, their tuition fee was 216 rupees. It remained the same after 5 years. Their library fee was 6 rupees, remained the same after 5 years, and an annual library development fee of 200 rupees, which was probably outrageous. And in Delhi University and JNU, you can't raise the fees for anything because people go on strike. So I guess the US pay a tuition fee of a lakh and a half, more than that. They're getting shortchanged. So, I mean, when you're working in this scenario, how do you decide on what exactly is affordable? And if you look at the social structures of Indian education, it is the student from Delhi Public School who is more likely to get into DSE than anybody else. Especially a lot of the liberal arts universities don't have an entrance exam. They go by the percentage of your 12th class marks. So the best private schools usually provide the best results. So the students are paying 90,000 in their private schools. The moment they come to Delhi School of Economics, the affordability question just simply goes out of the... Yes, he has. Take back my words. Anyway, it's a postgrad university. It's a postgrad college. But in my defense, their students go on to work for Citibank and Goldman Sachs. Okay, they're not exactly going and doing development work in the field, because that's what I got these statistics from one of their manuals, their brochures. The same brochure boasted that we send our students to Goldman Sachs. So now the question is, what is the future of copyright law? Because as you know, the publishers, after they lost the appeals case at Delhi, they withdrew the lawsuit. They said, we're not fighting this anymore. They had the option of going to the Supreme Court. But given the way the Supreme Court works these days, I guess it was a good option for them to withdraw it. So now the question is, what is going to happen in the future? And my guess is, wherever copyright law has failed, contract law is most likely going to triumph in those areas, because as you may have noticed, your education changed over the course of your time at Nalsar. You're using databases more. And while there are a lot of advantages to databases in the sense that, you know, you have a search functionality, it gives you access to a vast amount of information, the problem with databases is, one, you're bound by terms of contract. So if the contract chooses the law to be, say, UK law and provides for arbitration in the UK, your Indian copyright exceptions will not apply in that context. So that is one of the major changes that is going to happen. Your fair dealing is going to be restricted, and you're going to be buying a lot of stuff that you don't need, because that's the way databases are structured. You can't pick and choose what you want. Publishers will always bundle something which they don't need with something that you need. So that's going to be one of the challenges in the future. And we have to see how Indian universities deal with it. And one of the biggest problems is going to be the fact that right now a university buys a book or buys a journal, that copy is yours for life. You're not paying anybody every year. But with a database, universities are going to have to pay up every year for the same material, which is going to put a strain on budgets, and that is something that is a subject for future debate. Thank you for listening, and if you have any questions, I'd be willing to take them.